Good morning, everybody. Welcome back. It's so great to see so many faces joining us this morning. Give me one second, as we normally do. Let me move into just sharing my screen here. This is the only clunky part I love so much, and you all are always so patient with me. But it doesn't go as smooth as we like, but welcome. I'm Heather Ledoux. I'm the Executive Director of Professional Programs and Partnerships at Franklin Pierce University, and I also volunteer as the chair for our TechWomen Power Breakfast, which is an initiative within the New Hampshire Tech Alliance. And before we get into today's material, please share. I noticed this morning the majority of you here that have joined us this morning are regulars, which is wonderful. And some of you are brand new. And share the event out with everybody. So here's some places you could go. We have, if you go to the New Hampshire Tech Alliance to their website, you can find out all about all the other lovely events that we have. nhtechalliance.org/calendar. Tweet, use us on LinkedIn, Facebook, whatever your social media platforms, share it out. And we would appreciate it. For those of you who are new to the TechWomen Power Breakfast, I just wanted to thank you so much for getting up and camera ready for 7:30 in the morning, which we all know what a struggle that is these days to do, to be camera ready for 7:30. We have lots of things and balls in the air and things we're all trying to work on. So thank you for joining us. And the TechWomen Power Breakfast, like I mentioned, if you're not aware, it's made up of an amazing group of women who come together, and men, every single month, the second Wednesday of every month. And we come to grow professionally and personally. We share inspirational stories, we network, we really bring awareness to what is possible for women in tech today. And a couple housekeeping items before we move on as well. If you hadn't noticed, you are all on mute, so don't worry about that. When we're in presentation mode, like we are right now, I think your camera is probably off as well. And then at the end of the presentation today, we will have the room open from 9 to 9:30 for networking. So feel free to stick around and meet some people you haven't had a chance to connect with yet. Our Power Breakfast series is made possible due to our sponsors. So if you or your organization is interested in sponsoring one of our breakfasts, these are some of the benefits. You have the opportunity to speak at an event. You've probably attended one of our breakfasts where we've done a sponsor spotlight. You get to speak. You have your company name included on all our press releases prior to the event. And it really highlights your company's commitment to supporting women and girls in technology. So please consider sponsoring. And if you're interested in sponsoring, these are my committee members. Feel free to reach out to us. If it wasn't for the work of everybody in the committee, these breakfasts wouldn't happen either, especially when we had to switch gears, because normally, as most of you know, we meet in person at the Manchester Country Club. And thanks to the Alliance finding this wonderful platform, Remo, and everybody's hard work, we've been able to still bring these breakfasts every single month without really skipping a beat during this whole pandemic. And we have Shannon Herman, Ping King, Katie Geary, and Bhadana Sharma. So if you're curious about anything having to do with our tech breakfast, becoming a sponsor, interested in speaking, or topics that you think we should talk about, please reach out to one of us. And with that, I would like to welcome up my colleague, Shannon Herman.
Good morning, Heather. Thank you. For the introduction. Yes, my name is Shannon Herman. By day, I am a senior recruiting manager for Alexander Technology Group, but I also have the pleasure of working as the co-program coordinator for the entire TechWomen, TechGirls program. Heather, if you can just keep the slide up, that would be great. And One thing I did want to mention to you is that we are currently accepting nominations for our 6th annual TechWomen Awards. So once again, sadly, we are going to be remote and celebrating this remotely, but we do still want to recognize the amazing work that our students, our teachers, and our professionals are doing in our community, especially during 2020. It was a very interesting year. So nominations are open. Josh actually just dropped the nomination form in the chat here. But once again, we'll be looking to honor a tech professional of the year, a tech student of the year, and a tech teacher of the year. And that's recognizing their work for 2020. We do look forward to being back together probably right around this time next year to celebrate our 2021 award winners and probably bring together prior award winners that were only celebrated remotely. So please feel free to reach out to me with any questions. You do not need to nominate someone for all three. You can nominate just for one person. And we look forward to being able to have that virtual celebration in just a couple of months. So thank you for any nominations. And now I have the pleasure to introduce our speaker for today. You will be hearing from Kathleen Murphy. She's bringing over 25 years of experience in executive marketing in the high tech sector. And then a transition into amazing coaching platform. She's known for radiating enthusiasm, incredible energy, which even this morning she's bringing to the table, and just her ability to work with people, bring creative solutions, and solve problems. So thank you so much, Kathy, for joining us today, and we look forward to hearing from you.
So good morning, everybody. How are you? I obviously can't hear you saying hello back and good morning, but I want to thank you also for being here early this morning. I know that it's not always easy to get everything together to do this kind of thing in the morning. So it's something I really appreciate you doing and being here today. I'm going to share my screen right now so I can take you through what we're going to talk about today. Thank you for the nice introduction, Shannon and Heather. I appreciate that. Give me a second here and I'll share my screen. Today we're going to talk about something that is near and dear to my heart. It's motivation. But motivation is something that, as we know, isn't always there. Some days we wake up and we're perhaps a little bit less motivated than other days. So what do we do about that? And so today we're going to talk about that. So this is just a quick visual overview of my background. I'm not going to spend too much time on this, but I don't know if there are any UMaine Black Bears in the audience, but a shout out to the UMaine Black Bears if any of you are out there. And as was stated earlier, I spent 25 years in the tech space, and these are some of the companies that I work for. I didn't put some of the smaller companies up there because they would just be too cluttered. What's funny for those of you who are in tech, you'll appreciate this, but as you're aware of, a lot of tech companies are continuously in a cycle where they're trying to get acquired. So at this point, I think just about almost 100% of the companies, well, I should say 99, with the exception of Hitachi, were acquired by another company. Hence, us always having a very interesting sort of career cycle in the tech space, which can be a lot of fun because you can meet so many people that way, and you're always upping your game by learning new technologies, especially on the marketing side, where we try out new tech products to continuously enhance what we do in that world. So anyways, this is just a quick visual of what it is that I've been doing, spending my time since the mid 80s. And I started my company, MarketMe2, back in 2017. So this is what we're going to be covering today. First, what we're going to do is I'm going to be giving you 10 practical and immediately applicable tips on how to reduce your feelings of being overwhelmed. I know that certainly in in any industry, you're going to feel a lot of angst and potentially some feelings of being overwhelmed. So hopefully at least some of these tips will resonate with you today. I'm also going to tell you how you can harness your feelings of being overwhelmed to have that work in your favor. And I'm going to have you walk away from this presentation feeling like you're going to be able to conquer whatever is thrown at you today and then hopefully going forward. So that's my goal today. That's what we're going to be talking about. The first thing I want to do, though, is to just as a quick activity, I want you to think about what is your superpower. Let's give you a second here to think about that. Sometimes we don't necessarily, with all the things going on in our life, think that we have a superpower, but we surely do. And I guarantee you that you're probably putting it into action on a daily basis, whether you know it or not. So think about what it is. And I don't know if anyone wants to shout out on their mic in terms of what their superpower is, but I'm welcoming you to do that. Any takers in terms of telling me what your superpower is?
Because the chat here, Kathy, I've got Lexi saying patience, Lori, my superpower is a master connector, Renee, out of the box thinking, Susie, connecting in unusual ways.
I love it. Those are fantastic. Wow. Thank you. That's great. And part is you've got all day to do it. That's one of your challenges for today. All right. So we're going to switch gears here a little bit. And I'm sure most of you at some point have felt like this poor woman in this photo here. Maybe even as early as this morning, potentially. I know I felt this way when I got on early this morning and my internet connection wasn't behaving and the group couldn't see me on the video. They could possibly hear me, but my husband, luckily, who has a tech background, was able to come in and hardwire a new internet connection for me. So this is me this morning, actually. But later today, hopefully all of us will be feeling this way after we go through this presentation. So that's my goal today for you. Now, you're not alone. Lots of people feel the way that woman did and I did this morning. And the thing to think about is to factor in considering what are the contributors to being overwhelmed. We know that thanks to the pandemic, mental health has certainly been something that's contributing to making us feel more overwhelmed, more so than anything. But at the same time, I think we can also thank 2020 and the pandemic for putting a spotlight on the fact that mental health is so important. And then I'm hearing and reading a lot more about people going out and searching for solutions to perhaps address mental health challenges that they've been contending with for a long time, but then it was really brought to the forefront this past year. So that's a positive attribute in terms of one thing that COVID has done for all of us. So how about some other ideas in terms of what brings angst to us? What causes overwhelm? Let's hear some suggestions from people in terms of what they're experiencing in terms of this overwhelm and what's causing that to happen.
I'll jump in here again as the voice of the chat.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Too much to do.
Yes.
Juggling responsibilities professionally, parenting, spouse, daughter, etc. Not being able to say no, wanting to help everyone.
Yes.
Committing too much at one time. The lines between work and life blurring. I think everyone can agree with that right now. too many priorities and to-do lists.
Yes. Oh my gosh. Yeah. Like those are all incredible ones and all examples that we can probably, unfortunately, all relate to and perhaps are all struggling with. So those are. So what are some other overwhelmed suggestions? The pandemic, certainly, that we talked about, that has probably accelerated our angst level to a new level that most of us probably haven't felt ever before. And let's hope that we're seeing some light at the end of the tunnel to get us through that. Another thing that, and I mentioned this earlier about the mental health aspect, but that 1 in 12 people suffer from depression, which is an alarmingly high number. I would tend to say that it could even potentially be higher given the pandemic right now. So, but 1 in 12 is certainly pretty high. There's something called general anxiety disorder. And unfortunately, this is something that many women are twice as likely to be affected by. So I encourage you, if you or you know somebody that's experiencing this just heightened level of anxiety, to please go get help. I was just reading an article the other day by JC Monahan, who is on Channel 10. She's also a humane black bear, but she wrote just an incredibly personal article about her journey with depression and how she's been masking and hiding it for years. And she almost lost her life recently. And if it wasn't for one of her friends happening to call her, and luckily her being slightly aware enough to be able to pick up the phone, the friend realized that she sounded like she was in trouble, rushed over to her house. They got the paramedics to come over. She said she heard the words Narcan, and she was like, oh my gosh, you know, wow, I can't believe that I'm hearing this word. And when she woke up, she was in the hospital and she was being treated for major depression. And she said, here I am as a person that's telling other people's stories all the time. And I, you know, I'm a very private person. I don't typically tell my own story, but here I am feeling like I have to be authentic and I have to share my own story, because if it can help just one person to get some help or to feel like they're not alone, then I'm going to share the story. So check that story out in the Boston Magazine when you get a chance. It's a beautiful story. So what are some of the other reasons? Of course, one of them is the fact that we live in a world right now where everything has to be done right now. I mean, how many of you ever feel like someone says to you, oh, just, you know, give this to me next year, that's fine. Like that just doesn't happen. So much in our life is impacted by the fact that we're just so in the moment with everything having to be done immediately. Another thing that compounds our anxiety and just the overwhelm is the fact that we have so many choices. Like, look at this poor guy here trying to figure out what drink to pick out. That's kind of like me, I think, sometimes when I go to the supermarket. So I can relate to that. But there are obviously lots of other choices that we're constantly bombarded and faced with, such as the career, the family, the friends, the health, life, that are in this little signpost there. Then decisions, you know, this poor woman, hopefully she's going to decide not to go swim with the sharks. And I was laughing a little bit about the sign, because it looks like it's kind of a permanent sign. So the fact that they see maybe sharks every day, I don't think I'd ever be swimming in that water. But the fact that, you know, we always are making decisions, that is also compounding the overwhelm that we feel, whether we realize it or not. So I feel like there are very few days where we can actually say that we're not making lots of decisions. And part of that has to do with the fact that so many of us are moms and you know, we're working, or we're women, and we just feel the responsibility for always being in the mindset of caring, sometimes more so for others than ourselves. So this also impacts our situation. And a lot of times, you know, we get to a point where we feel like, you know, our brain is just like fried and on overload, like this poor little puppy. Hopefully they got him out of there, because that looks like a little bit of a treacherous situation. And then does anyone feel these same emotions in the chat? Like, do you feel this? Is it just me? I don't think so, but I'd like to maybe just get some feedback from the audience. Shannon, we're getting some.
Yeah, we're seeing a yes, yes, definitely. It's not just you. The need to make decisions all the time is overwhelming. I feel like the weekend's not long enough to just let it go and have
right.
to make decisions and be busy then. You know, we're all here, aren't we? So
yes,
too many choices paired with the need to make too many decisions.
Yes, yes, exactly. And the fact that I think the reality that the lines have been blurred for work and home because we are working from home. I think many of us feel that we're probably working even longer because that time that maybe we'd be using to commute to work when we could maybe do something else, talk on the phone, listen to the radio, podcast, et cetera, that isn't necessarily occurring. I mean, we can still build that into our schedule, certainly, but I don't think a lot of us are probably doing that. So it might be something just to consider as a tip to build that time in that we normally would have to decompress or kind of gear up for the day. So thank you for those suggestions, that feedback. I appreciate it. There's good news. You don't have to feel overwhelmed. We do have the power to, in fact, not feel that way. So let's go through some of these ways that we can do that. One of the things to do is to have the mindset of a turtle. We all know potentially the story of the tortoise and the hare, and we know who won in that race. So have the mindset of trying to, and I'm guilty of this too, to try to slow down. I have to remind myself to go into turtle speed because I'm always in the hare speed, the rabbit speed all the time, and I'm constantly trying to dial it back a little bit. But this is something that we can all do. And yes, I'm talking to you. So if you're looking around, if there's any question about that. So, okay, so let's buckle up here. So I'm going to ask everybody to find something that they can write on or type into. I'm going to give you a minute here to go find something so that we can launch into this because I'm going to have you write down some things that will be helpful to you in this process of becoming gaining back the power of not being overwhelmed. Okay, I'm going to move forward. So I'm going to launch into the 10 tips to feel less overwhelmed. The first tip is to remember, and this is really important, that life is a journey and it's not a sprint. But in fact, we're constantly in the mode of being in sprint mode, especially we're even on teams that do sprints in, you know, the Kanban and, you know, the different methods that we use for getting projects moved forward. So it's hard to kind of sometimes go back to remembering that life is a journey and that work can be a journey too. We don't always have to accomplish everything, you know, every single day. Of course, we all like to try to tick things off of our to-do box, but it is important, especially when we are outside of work, to go back to feeling like we're actually on that VW bus, driving along, having a nice little journey there. The other thing that I want you to do right now is to stand up, wave your arms around, and stomp your feet. Literally, just everybody do that. I'm going to do that right now myself. And we've, you know, gotten up early. Some of us may have even skipped our exercise. I don't always exercise in the morning. I like to do it in the afternoon if I can, but double exercise for those of you this morning who get to do this. But this is really an important thing to do. So even this small activity of waving your arms and stomping your feet every maybe hour, on the hour, I think being at home, it's a little bit easier for us to do this, but this can actually just kind of, you know, re-energize you. So keep that in mind. That's really important to do. And we did that. So kudos. Thanks for everybody participating. I'll assume that you did. One of the other nice things that we can certainly do is to listen to music or comedy. One of the things that in particular I enjoy doing, and I started doing this a few years ago, was to listen to podcasts about comedy in the morning, because I mean, let's face it, there's nothing better than really laughing or having a good laugh in the morning. So consider doing that. You know, there are some amazing comedians out there that, you know, some of you may have a favorite comedian. Listen to their work, support them. And I like to tell people also to try to think about, you know, maybe limiting some of their time to unwind to about 30 minutes, just in case, you know, you get carried away. 30 minutes is like luxurious from my perspective, especially if it's during the course of the day. Another thing that you can do is to fire up your creative abilities. My daughter just had her birthday the other day, and I gave her some gifts that sort of were trying to touch upon a variety of different aspects of her life, one of them being creative. And so we're going to go to this place in New Hampshire, Nashua, New Hampshire, called Time to Clay. And it's a place where you can go and you can paint pottery. So we're going to be activating our creative mind coming up in the next few weeks. So I'm really excited about that. But, you know, gardening counts too, painting, playing an instrument, anything that you might have that you can do that would be considered creative is absolutely something that you try to factor into doing on a regular basis. Perhaps if you can schedule it in on a daily basis, even if it's just doodling. I mean, it could be something like putting a puzzle together. We recently started doing puzzles in our house. We had a 1,000 piece puzzle, and it was just so relaxing. And it was just a real kind of escape, and doing something as simple as that can really make a difference for you. I like this one. This one is one of my favorites. And oftentimes I'll tell my clients, this is something that I encourage them to do. We all know that we probably are a little bit guilty, myself included, of spending a little bit too much time on social media. And there are probably people in our social media world and in our real world that we potentially have to socially weed out that may not be good for us. And who are some of these people? These are the people that are these negative people that we come across. We know who they are. Sometimes we can avoid them. Other times we can't. But if there is a way to limit the amount of time that you spend with these people, then do that. Another tip I'll share with you is a couple of years ago, I literally used to watch the news every morning. I'd wake up, turn on the news. I don't do that anymore. I found that the news was just absolutely draining me and making me really upset. And sometimes I would even be crying in the morning before I'd go to work. I'm like, this is ridiculous. I have to stop doing this. So I literally have cut out basically watching the news. So I get my news in other ways, but I choose to go and seek out news myself through different venues on my own without being having to subscribe to what's being put in front of me. And most of the time the news is reporting on, let's face it, things that aren't so great that are happening. I think for a time there were some podcasts out there that focused on just positive news. And I love that. I was like, all right, that's great. Let's bring us more of that. So again, turn off all your social media if you can, even if it's just for a short period of time. I think, you know, there are certainly some positive aspects to social media, but I think that by and large, there are probably some more negatives in the column for this particular category. So one of the things that I want you to do now is to craft a list of the things that are contributing to having you be overwhelmed. Now, it doesn't have to be, you know, an extensive list. It could just be perhaps the top five things, maybe 10 things. I don't know. It depends on your situation. But we're going to use this list in a different way in a minute. And you can continue to think about this and put this information down on your list. So we'll move along here. Another thing that we're going to be doing is, and this can continue past this talk today, but don't assume that you have to get all of these things on your list done today. That's part of the challenge of trying to not necessarily have to feel as if you constantly have to be in accomplishment mode 100% of the time. The trick, as most of you know, because you're all professionals and you work in the tech space, so we're really accustomed to being productive and accomplishing things and achieving things, is to prioritize. But we don't always do that in our own life. We do that probably exceptionally well professionally, but many of us are probably guilty of maybe not prioritizing things in our life in terms of having that contribute in a positive way to helping us with this overwhelm. And then what I also want you to do is, if you want to create like another column, come up with some solutions to each of those overwhelm challenges. Some of them may be obvious. Some of them you maybe scratch your head going, I don't know. And so if you're going, I don't know, ask somebody else. Share your list with somebody. And you'd be amazed when you share your list with somebody, the kind of feedback that you might get from them. They may say, oh my gosh, I had no idea that these are things that you were overwhelmed by or that you were challenged with. My gosh, let me give you a hand. And potentially you're going to get some new support. So that's a byproduct of this, which is a great thing. So what I also want you to do is to rate these items on your overwhelm list and rate them on a scale of 1 to 10. 10 is off the charts in a bad way. We don't want them too many of them to be 10. But if you see that about half of your list is at a 5 rating, let's have you work on the ones that are much lower first, because let's activate your brain and get the endorphins going to have you tick off like the box of accomplishing something. So pick the easy ones first. That's what I recommend here. And so you'll be able to work on that over the course of time. Another thing I recommend is talking to a friendly person or hanging out with a pet, spending a little bit of time doing that each day if you can, or if you don't have a pet. My dog, unfortunately, of 9 years passed away back in October, and I used to love going to the dog park, and I was really sad that, you know, he wasn't around anymore. The good news and unexpected news is that our daughter, who is living with us since COVID occurred, happened to get a puppy a couple weeks after he passed away. So actually she tried coming into the office here where I was right before this presentation, but she's a little 7-month-old Frenchie. But that's made a huge difference in my life. And I know that whenever I'm feeling stressed or overwhelmed, I just go find Luna, go play with her, have her chase a stick outside or take her for a walk, and makes you feel a lot better. So if you don't have a pet, like I said, you can also even just, you know, watch YouTube videos with pets, especially the baby pets are especially something that makes me smile and makes me feel happy. And then the last thing that I'll say is to go back to your list and to complete half of your list, but to be reasonable in terms of getting through this list. Let's have you get through your list in the next 1 to 2 weeks. If that doesn't seem reasonable, stretch out the time frame. You're in control. So that's what this is really all about. And then you're going to be breaking down your priority numbers to help you to focus. And then, you know, in a couple of weeks, you're going to be able to go back to your list, or maybe in a month from now, and go, oh my gosh, look at all the things that I accomplished. Isn't that fantastic? That's great. Pat yourself on the back and you'll smile. So another tip that I have for you, and I love this one also, is, and everybody can do this right now, but let's clap. And I'm going to read you something about clapping here also. It is, believe it or not, it's supported by science in terms of clapping is something that can make you happy. And we clap our hands, if you think about it, because we're usually doing so to encourage people for doing good work, for achievements, and it's a positive expressive activity. But it's something so simple that we can do that we should all, you know, consider doing on a regular basis. And according to the World Health Organization, they have confirmed that clapping hands, you'll like this one, is one of the best exercises in daily activities. So if you just can't find time to exercise, I guarantee you, you can find time to clap, even if it's just for a minute. And I want to sign up for that exercise program because I know I can accomplish that, and it doesn't require a gym membership either. So, and then for you yoga fans out there, apparently clapping is one of the ancient yoga poses in yoga nasa. I'm probably mispronouncing that, but you get the point. And then there are so many benefits also other than this supporting why this is so good by science. And clapping is one of those things that can boost your immune system. I mean, imagine that. So that's pretty fabulous that something as simple as that can do that. It strengthens your white blood cells that protect the body from any kinds of illnesses, including heart conditions, hypertension, diabetes, depression, asthma, common cold, back, neck, joint and pain and headaches, insomnia, and hair loss. Gosh, imagine that. So anyways, the point is, you get the point. Do some clapping, everybody. It's something simple to do. Doesn't cost you anything. And it's going to obviously give you some pretty amazing benefits. All right. So what are some of the key takeaways today? Let's go through that. We've covered a lot over the course of this last 25 minutes or so. Let's keep in mind that being overwhelmed can, in fact, be temporary. And we do have control to take it over and take back not feeling that way. And it's important to recognize and document what it is that is causing us this overwhelm and to come up with a plan for each of these things. And I've set you up today, hopefully, to be able to go for it and do just that. Keep in mind, move around, be creative. As I suggested, listen to some music, listen to comedy. And important other note is to reduce the negative people or those influences that are in our life that cause us more anxiety. Of course, this one, love this one, find a pet or friend to spend some time with. And then keep in mind, and this is really hard to do, but go into turtle mode, and not everything has to be done right now. And then importantly as well is that life is, in fact, as we know, a journey. But sometimes we forget about that. We're always in Olympic sprint mode, but try to go back to remember that it is a journey. And most importantly, I know you can do this. So I'm counting on you. So now, after you've gotten through your list and you've written these things down, you got a plan, you've rated them, and you know that in a couple of weeks from now, you're going to have these things potentially under control and in a different situation, you should feel this way. Now, I happen to pick a beach scene because that's my happy place where I like to go. And I think finding a starfish is pretty special. So hence the reason for these images here. But I'm sure potentially all of you have your own special image of your happy place as well. So just substitute these happy images for yourself. And then sort of to toss in the technical aspect of this particular presentation, because I was asked to, you know, be mindful of the fact that this is a tech audience, if you will. I don't know if anyone out there has been on Clubhouse. I was introduced to Clubhouse probably a couple months ago right now, but in the chat, let's have everybody just say, yes, you've been on it, or no, I never heard about it, or make a comment about it, and then I'll have Shannon chime in.
All right. We've got a bunch of no's. We've got Julie, who loves being on Clubhouse. I'll keep an eye out for you there, Kathleen. Never heard of it. Never heard of it. No. So a couple people looks like they're waiting on invites. And a couple people said yes.
Oh, all right. Well, I think I have some invites. So for those of you who are looking, DM me, or you'll have my contact information so I can send that to you. But I find that Clubhouse, you know, I sort of go back and forth in my mind in terms of whether I like it or not. It can be overwhelming because they're constantly sending you pings in terms of who is on Clubhouse, who's talking. Clubhouse originally started probably about a year or so ago. It was funded by Andreessen, which is a very large VC, I believe is out in the Silicon Valley area. And it was founded to originally have celebrities be able to go to a place where they could talk to one another without fans or anybody else there. And they could kind of just socialize with one another, especially during the pandemic, in a way that allowed them to just, you know, be able to be themselves and talk to other people that have similar challenges that they do being celebrities. And then it opened up to the general public, and it's audio only, which is something that's one of the pluses that I like about it, is the fact that you don't have to get all glammed up and go on. You can go on at any point in time. You can kind of just listen in. You don't have to participate. You can talk if you want to. You can set up your own room if there's some particular topic that you're really passionate about that you want to talk about. So it kind of gives you a platform to be able to do that. And I had my own room for a little while, but I found that it was a little distracting, taking up more time. So I may go back to that, but I'm not currently running my room on my topics. But if you haven't checked it out, if you're interested, poke around, see if you know anybody else that's out there that is on it. Like I said, I think I have some invites. But it is invite only right now. They will eventually be opening up like all the other social media platforms that are out there. But there are definitely some benefits to it because there are channels on there that talk about specifically topics that I'm sure you're going to find something that really lights you up and that you're interested in. So check it out. I have nothing to do with Clubhouse other than the fact that I was a participant in it. And so thank you for your feedback on that. So surprise for everybody today. I mentioned earlier that I'm an author and my first book is called Wisdom Whisper. My second book is called Evolve with the Wisdom Whisper. And in my books, I share my journey of what it was, you know, like in the corporate space and talk about topics that I wish I had known the answers to or had more insight to. Or tips about as I was coming up as a tech woman executive. And the format of my books are a little unusual in that there's 50 stories in each of the books and each story is 2 pages in length. And you don't have to read the book sequentially. You can kind of go in there almost like a buffet and pick the topic that resonates with you and dive in and read about it. So it was really intended to be a virtual mentor book for anybody that could gain benefit from knowing what I will call tongue-in-cheek my secrets in terms of what I learned in the tech space. So I'm going to have Shannon and her team figure out who the two lucky people are that are going to get this book, and I'll get your address and I'll send it off to you and I'll autograph it for you. So that's my surprise today. And for those of you who aren't selected to be the winner, I have another way for you to check out some of my reading as well, or you could buy one of my books. Or if you want to contact me, I'm going to give people a discount today. It is available on Amazon, but I'm ordering up my own supply so I can send it directly to you if you're interested. And I will offer my books at $15, which is a $5 discount. So just something to offer to you. Okay, now I'm going to open it up if there are any questions at this point, and we'll see if there are any questions. I'm also going to be available. I'll stick around if anyone wants to do any kind of networking. I'm happy to do that. So I'll be around until 9:30, which I guess is when the networking ends.
Thank you so much, Kathleen. Yeah, so if anybody has any questions, let's move it over to the Q&A box out of the chat box. It'd just be easier for us to manage. Just put it in there. So the first question is the book only geared for executives, Kathleen?
No, it's actually geared for a wide range of people. It's interesting because I've had people actually at the high school level that are reading my book. I was coaching a high school sports team. I was their performance coach. And they were young men between the ages of 14 to 18. And a number of them were reading my book. So you could be as young as 14 and you could be well into your career, decades into your career, and gain benefit from it. I have had CEOs reading my book. And everybody in between, someone from, you know, day one in their work, in their first work assignment, to the top level person out there. Thank you for your question.
That's great. The next question is, what about the invisible wall called depression? How do we break that down first? Everything hinges on that.
So I'm obviously not a psychologist or a therapist. But I do have personal experience from my family in regards to dealing with depression. And it's something that I highly recommend that you talk to somebody about that is a professional. I would start with your general practitioner and go and let them know that you're having some challenges. They're the first line of defense. But I mean, you can also talk to people in your family, but if you're feeling that you have any kind of depression, even if it's mild depression, there are so many things that you can do about it. And you don't always have to get put on medication. That's not always the first go-to place. I do know that for a fact, because I know that some people are not in support of medication. So there are lots of other things that you can do, such as controlling your diet differently. I know sugar is a very large contributor to people's feeling poorly or well, and exercise, certainly doing meditation and yoga. There are a lot of holistic things that you can do that can help with depression, but it's definitely something that you shouldn't feel like you have to tackle alone. It's not something that anybody has to contend with single-handedly.
Thank you for that answer, Kathleen.
You're welcome.
What I'd like everyone to do is, Kathleen offered up her her book to two lucky people. Why don't we use the raise the hand feature? This is a new feature in Remo, so it's a perfect opportunity for us to use it, and I want to try it out. So somewhere in your toolbar, because I'm in presentation mode, I don't have access to it, raise your hand if you're interested in being one of the people to receive the book. So just raise your hand, and then somehow, Josh, we may have to do this afterwards because this is being recorded, so I can go back and look, and then we can pick the winners. But thank you. Yeah, raise the hand. Okay, so we have everyone who's raised their hand who's interested in the book, and then we can pick two people from there. Okay, thanks, Josh. He took a screenshot, so perfect. So then we can we'll select the two people, and we'll make sure we get in contact with you. Or if Josh, you want to figure that out now, that'd be great. Okay, you and then we're gonna thank you everyone for participating in that. We will lower the hands in a second, and I'm gonna go back to the next question. So someone else asked, nothing on my list can be eliminated in a couple weeks. Most are out of my control or long-term goals. How do you recommend reducing the overwhelm for long-term items?
So that's a great question. And I'm sure many of you probably have some items like that on your list. I'm sorry that all of your items seem to feel like they fall into that category. But my recommendation is this, and this is something that I do myself. And, you know, having a marketing background and having to do projects, you know, for 25 years, and of course, having to continue to do projects in my in my business, when I have a really big project or something that seems absolutely overwhelming, what the first thing that I do is I break it down into steps. I think about where do I even begin to start with this project? And I don't even necessarily have to, you know, start with knowing what step number one is. I can just kind of, I love writing things down. I'm a very visually oriented person. So I write them down. I put them in front of me, and I just start writing things down in terms of knowing what I need to do in order to accomplish getting that item done. And I just make it as an exhaustive list as possible. And then I'll come back to it, even like the next day or the day after. I'll keep kind of it running. And before you know it, I've got a really large chunk of, if you will, to-dos that I can then go back and I can start to organize it into sections in terms of, okay, well, if I were to chunk this out into four different phases, which one of these items would go into phase one, and then, you know, go through that process. And when you, and then I, you know, it have, then I would assign maybe some dates, and maybe there are contingencies for some of those actions that require help from somebody else. It's not something that I can do all by myself. So I will note, okay, I need help from so-and-so and fill in the blank. So I try to construct sort of a visual frame and map of my, how do I go on this journey to complete this project so it doesn't feel as overwhelming. And so because you have a lot of those, you can do that same example throughout for each one of those. And that's what I do. I tackled yesterday a project that I've literally been avoiding for months. I was just dreading doing it. It was going to require me probably 8 hours of solid, just focus work. What I did the day before was I netted out like, okay, what did I need to do to like make this happen? So I kind of set myself up for success to be able to do this. And I kind of geared myself up and to get excited about doing it because I really didn't want to do it. So I had to like coach myself into doing it. So even as a motivation coach, you can imagine sometimes there are days when, you know, I might not want to do something, and then who do I call on? No, I do have coaches that I can reach out to and people that I can reach out to my life to motivate me. But that's my recommendation. And I hope that helps.
Thanks, Kathleen. We have another question.
You're welcome.
Is there one thing that you have done that has helped you determine where or how to balance work and life with kids? Example, would things be a better balance if I pulled back from work and or worse?
So I think it depends on your financial situation, right? Because it can cause more stress for you if you're thinking, all right, is there a way to maybe go from 5 days down to 4 days, and would having that extra day, if I didn't have to take a cut in pay, but if I can negotiate with my boss to do my, you know, X number of hours or to get all my work done within a set amount of days. And I personally have tried this myself, and I know a lot of other women that have done this too, and some men as well, where they've chosen a day that they don't work. They literally devote that day to themselves or to their family. And having that extra day, that third day, if you will, in the weekend, even if it's like on a Wednesday, if you're breaking up your week, can make a tremendous difference. And I think, you know, it's really a difficult decision sometimes in terms of being able to prioritize and to balance your life. And it's something that I think more women unfortunately feel the burden of. Although, you know, I don't want to generalize, there are amazing husbands and, you know, partners out there that definitely are doing their equal share. But I think women sometimes will feel more out of balance because they're not getting the support from their partner or their husband or whoever else is involved in their life. And I think some of that has to do with the fact that we don't ask, that we just sometimes silently suffer and we'll just take on the burden and, you know, kind of just muscle through it. We shouldn't do that. I mean, just like we need to communicate. Women are exceptionally strong communicators. So we need to be like, just, you know, put your strong, you know, work hat on and your confidence hat on, like you have at work, and use that in your personal life to get to the place that you need to be for balance. It's not easy. I had help with my kids. My kids are a little bit older now. My youngest is 20. My middle daughter is 24 and my oldest son is 26, but I had nannies helping me all throughout the time that I was, you know, in the thick of the workforce. I couldn't have done it without them. I couldn't have done it without my family. And did I feel guilty about that? Sure, some days that I did, but, you know, I picked the best caregivers that I could to strike the balance because I knew that I wasn't a stay-at-home kind of mom. And I knew that I would feel better contributing to the family by working. But I also knew that if I picked the right people that to help support me, that they were just part of my team.
Yeah, we had a speaker a while ago, and she had said, when you have all those balls in the air, pick which ones are your glass balls and which ones are the plastic balls. Because your glass balls, you can't drop, you know, if they drop, they break, and that's then. But the plastic ones, they can bounce. So just figure out which ones are your glass balls and which ones are your plastic balls and which ones you can let drop at the moment.
That's an excellent piece of advice.
So we do have another question. Any tips on being better at delegating? I often find myself doing more because it's quicker for me to do things versus relying on others.
Yes. And this is something that comes up with my clients quite often, even at the executive level. But delegating is hard to do because it requires us to put the responsibility into somebody else's hands. And for those of you that are perfectionists or would potentially self-admit to being maybe a bit more of a control type person, this can be really hard for you. And so what I recommend doing is to do it in very small amounts and to start slowly, because it's not going to be easy for you. But you will realize that you're going to actually be able to get a whole lot more done and potentially be able to focus on a lot more things that you're interested in doing when you do start to delegate. Delegate the things that you feel as if, all right, well, if somebody screws this up, the world isn't going to end, or I'm not going to get fired, or, you know, that glass ball isn't going to shatter. And so I know that there are things that you can find in the course of your work life or your personal life that you can delegate. It's just a matter of you have to commit to wanting to do it, and it takes practice. It's not something that comes easily to most people, because they feel like, well, I can do it. Like, why should I delegate it to somebody? You know, it's going to, you know, take twice as long for somebody else to do it. That's okay. And you know, you have to become comfortable with the fact that it's okay for somebody else to do it maybe differently. I'll give you an example of that. And this is a personal one with my kids. So as I mentioned, we had nannies helping to bring up our kids, and they would come to our house. They weren't live-ins. And I realized one day that I was watching my daughter tie her shoes. And I realized I didn't teach her how to tie her shoes. And I realized this because she tied her shoes completely differently than I tie my shoes. And so I was like, wow. So, you know, without even kind of knowing it, I delegated something that's really important, right? To being able to tie your shoes so you don't trip over them, to somebody else. And so sometimes realizing that you can do that, and the end of the world isn't going to occur can be really freeing. And I think the like I said earlier, the more you do it, the easier it becomes, but you constantly kind of have to practice it, and you can kind of get rusty if you aren't doing it, but it does get much easier to delegate. But just start small. Like, don't beat yourself up over the fact that you may not be good at it. I'm not a perfectionist, which is a, I think, you know, a good thing in some ways, in other ways, maybe not. But I find it a little bit easier to delegate for that reason. But I appreciate the fact that it can be exceptionally hard to do for everybody. It's not an easy thing to do. I hope that helps.
Yeah, it's very freeing to be able to let go.
Yes.
Exactly. Someone had just made a comment just saying that as an FYI to everybody, Audible.com has been promoting Talkspace as an online counseling for those looking for therapy options. So I just wanted to share that out in case no one read that.
Oh, that's great. Q&A.
So I think that wraps up the, there's no more questions in the Q&A. If anyone does have one, you can pop one in right now. Kathleen, thank you so much. I definitely had a few takeaways. I enjoy the clapping. So it's funny because that is like a natural instinct, because sometimes if I hear a really funny joke, I do the belly laugh and I just clap. So I didn't even realize that it was an instinctual, like, happiness.
Yeah. Is that nice?
Yeah. And you could do your, stop sharing, cause we're seeing all your stuff going on right now. That's if you want to, and we'll still be in presentation mode. So no worries. And also that I wanted to add that for some of your takeaways and things for being motivated and de-stressing, obviously everybody who's attending today at our TechWomen Power Breakfast, I think is another thing. Obviously you recognize that for those of you who are regulars and those are your first time, hopefully you can recognize that. So maybe that could be, you know, part of your motivation and de-stressing during the pandemic. At least we hope so. That's been part of our goal. So, so thank you so much, Kathleen. It was so wonderful. Really enjoyed the topic. I definitely got lots of takeaways. And, you know, one of my things when you talked about things to do, like most people, home improvements, because we've been looking at all our walls and I'm like, got to paint that. I got to do this. And so I'm feeling a little overwhelmed with that.
You're welcome. It was my pleasure. It was an honor to speak to your group. Thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And hopefully at least one of those tips helps somebody.
I'm sure that everybody was feverishly writing down things to do and taking away tips. So thank you again so much. I'm gonna share my screen again, everybody, just so I can last couple slides. Little clunky. The one thing that I wanted to mention also. Check out the Tech Alliance's website because there's a job fair coming up on the 21st. So reach out to Josh with any questions with that. If you know anyone who's looking for a job, if you're an employer who's hiring, there's probably still time to be involved with that. So check that out on the 21st, or just like I said, go to their website or reach out to Josh in regards to that. And next month, please join us on May 12th, Daniela Connolly, doctor and chief science officer for Harmony Media. She is going to be talking to us in regards to the virtual reality prescription, a new frontier in medicine. And she's going to be reviewing a key brain function that can lead to depression and isolation. She'll talk about fascinating new insights into how to tame this runaway brain function and how virtual reality, VR, might become a standard treatment in the future. And she'll explore the work Harmony Media. It's a female-founded startup and what they're doing in the VR mental health and wellness space. So I hope you can join us. And with that said, thank you again. It's been my honor and my privilege to be able to bring to you another monthly breakfast. Hope to see you all on May 12th. For everybody who is new, thank you so much. Share the word. For those of your regulars, we appreciate you keeping it going until someday that, you know, we meet in person again. But do stay tuned because we've had so much feedback for so many people that they're loving this virtual format. So even though when the world does go back to normal and we can see your beautiful faces in person, we're probably going to have both aspects. So do stay tuned on that. Again, have a wonderful day, everybody. And for those of you who want to stick around, please do so. We'll be chatting around till 9:30. Have a great day, everybody. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Heather.
Bye-bye.